Hello all, this is Minister Edward J. Robin here on the 20th day of February, 2021. I thought I should do a little roundup for those people who have been listening to me patiently for years now. I've been doing videos for about 14 years, maybe a little bit longer. At any rate, the reason I think most people watch me is they find that nobody else in the world seems to give them an outside of the box view so they can understand what's going on and how I give people a greater perception of how this is a religious fraud. I'll say that again. The whole world that we have been brought up in and live in is a religious fraud. So first of all, I'll start off with the biblical story so people can understand the foundation of this religious fraud. As the story goes, God created everything in the beginning. And I'm certainly not going to go into the debate of where God came from. All I will tell you is if you understand infinity, and most people cannot, and I'll say most because there may be a few out there that have finally figured it out. But that's pretty much, in a nutshell, what God is. First law of physics, energy has no beginning and no end. So with that, we had a beginning. As the scripture goes, God created Adam and Eve, the first man and the first woman. And there are many speculations about that perception of a beginning. And that's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm here to talk about the religious fraud and give you an idea how it took place, the motivation behind it, and how to escape it. That's basically what I'm here for. So God created Adam and Eve, and he gave them a beautiful garden with which to live in. Everything was there for them. They only had one position that they had to observe, and that was not to eat this central tree, the tree of knowledge. God had strongly forbidden them to eat of this tree, having full knowledge before he created everything that would be a necessity to set the ball in motion so that the purification of man's soul would take place, so that man, a choosing entity with the ability to make good decisions and bad decisions, would eventually weed out all those who made bad decisions, leaving behind only those who made good decisions. And we'll deem good decision as not hurting anybody, loving people. So God creates the whole earth based upon the survival of the fittest principle. Only the strong shall survive in the genetics of the creation of the earth. That's the way it was designed. That's not speculation. Only one only has to go into the jungle for a while and you'll see the survival of the fittest law taking place. There is no charter or bill of rights or anything like that in the jungle. There's just raw life and death. So God creates that and puts Adam and Eve in the middle of that, in this beautiful garden where everything was just free. And because the choice, as necessitated by God's design, was to make a mistake and an error, they ate that bad fruit. I'll say bad because it made them aware that they were naked, and that nakedness was somehow not to be seen, and God made them some clothes because he realized they'd eaten from the tree and they needed to cover themselves. We're not going to go into why. I'm just trying to give you a basic understanding of how later on man became corrupted. Noah had to build an ark to get away from all that corruption. Well, God washed clean the earth, give them another start at it. In other words, okay, we've centralized the majority of the bad seed here. Let's wash those away. And these people here, Noah's family, those are the good ones. We'll see if we can create a new start with a better generation of good seed. So Noah comes out of the arks with his son, Ham, Japheth, and Shem, and they proceed to fill the earth again. Again, to bring out the bad seed and the corruption. And we have a Tower of Babel coming along pretty soon. Nimrod, the grandson of, I think it was Shem, and it went on, or maybe it was Ham. As the story goes, each new generation gets worse. More corruption, more lusty, more insecurity of, I've only got so many days on earth, I'm going to take advantage of my time. And back then, they were living a lot longer. I think Methuselah lived over 900 years. So their time on earth, that adventure there with a higher oxygen content and a higher nutrition level of food, certainly a better ozone layer around the earth, protecting them from ultraviolet radiation. They grew rapidly and they were very strong and healthy and intelligent. Over a period of time, it looks like, as were there in the beginning, that some angels came down from heaven and mated with the daughters of men. This is exterior DNA, exterior and different from the DNA of men and women on the earth. Because when they mated, they produced giants, Nephilim. So here we have evidence in the Bible that God had designed life someplace else, from the heavens, wherever that, there's lots of planets and stars out there with planets revolving around them, so it doesn't really matter where, but we can see that there was some other place the DNA code was put together so they could breed with the codes of men and women here on the earth. So that took a place not only before the flood, but after the flood, when we can see in Job, God's consulting with Satan, one of his head angels who decided to rebel, and asked him where he was. He said, well, I've been walking to and fro on the earth. So here we go after the flood. Satan's back down there again, mating with the daughters of men, with his band of angels that had followed him. And that creates more giants. And we can see that David slew one of those giants with a stone from his sling. And there were many others written in the Old Testament that had beds that were like 15 cubits long, etc. So they were huge, huge people. Remembering again, a genetic code from something exterior to the earth had come down, one of God's creations, and had made it. So we go on in time and we see this kings take place where people got tired, I guess, of following God, and they said, we want kings! And God advised against it. And then he said what would happen if they put kings in power, that the kings would eventually control you because they'd get lusted with the power, and it would get worse and worse and worse. And of course, that's what it did. And God put a set of people in that Old Testament that were to be his chosen people in charge of everything, the Israelites, or the Hebrews, as they were first called. And just like any other group of people in the Bible, they ventured over into the dark side and sin and became lusting after sexual pleasures and money and all kinds of frivolities, foods and things that were depriving their body's temple of the necessity of respect. And so those generations of people produced more lusting, sinning people. And God eventually got tired of this nation he had set as his bride because it was off whoring after other gods. And so God divorced them, these people that today are called the Jewish nation, Judaic. God divorced them. I need to say that several times because I certainly didn't write God's opinion when he divorced those people. And the reasoning why he divorced them, because they had literally gone worshiping over false gods. And so that divorce is a very important aspect in that Old Testament because God had designated those people as to be control over everybody else. His chosen people were to remain in power at the top of the list. And as a result of that, he had told them in Leviticus 25, 44 through 50, after coming out of Egypt there with a bunch of Ammonites, people that weren't following God, but rather worshiped the old false god of Egypt, Ammon, And they were hanging around the edges of the camp, and they were stealing, and they weren't following God's law. And so God instructed Moses to go and purchase them and make them possessions forever. In Leviticus 25, there, 44 through 50. So those people, when they got divorced, well, they lost their ability to have free labor because God destroyed the covenant that he had made with them as of that divorce. Well, a lot of them didn't like that much. Free labor for the rest of your life, forever, was a pretty good plan, and all of their children's children's children. And so they resisted that divorce and maintained that they were God's chosen people. And this, of course, took place right forward up until Christ's time, when he came to wash away all of the assumption that they had brought slavery upon men and women of the earth, to wash away all of that law that was contrary to God's law. And that Christ's new command was to love your Lord God with all your heart and soul and mind, and to love your brother as yourself. There's the new covenant. All that old covenant with the Judaic nation was washed away. Again, they, not being very happy with losing their free labor, rejected that, and to this day are still operational under the fact that they rejected Christ, they rejected the divorce, and they still act as if they're God's chosen people, controlling the finances and indeed all of the properties of the royal estate worldwide. That word royal is real. That's the way it is said in Scottish, as it is in the land of the leal. That means the land of the loyal. So if you're talking about real estate, you're talking about royal estate. And that royal estate is after the rule of the kings. The kings took authority over the land as God's steward. As you can see in Genesis 1:26 in those scriptures, God designated man as having dominion over the earth. And what these royalty have designated is that we are godless, we don't know any better, and they've taken authority over the land as crown estate. That's royal estate. And they hold it in trust because of our dumb goyim actions of not knowing God, respecting God, and being lawless in our lust to take power and control over God's property and land. So this is what the kings and queens have done for centuries. They've taken trust and authority, parens patria, over all of the land as royal estate. And we have been classified as registrants within that royal estate as beneficially owned property. As you can see in Leviticus 25, 44 through 50, being lived out. Those of you in Canada may have read the Canadian Ownership Control and Determination Act, 1982, and the 1984 regulations that were revised in 1984 from the original 1982 regulations in this Canadian Ownership Control and Determination Act. This is an enactment about slavery, inviting us to read Leviticus 25, 44 through 50. Those of us that are tenacious enough to go through the words and break open a dictionary to learn what we are reading, to find out that yes, indeed, this is not an opinion, that this is an enactment about slavery. Volunteered men and women into a dead corporate entity becoming constitutors, those who by a simple agreement promise to pay the debt of another. Now these men and women today that God in through his son in Revelations 2:9-9 designated as false Jews, they are to, for us to be aware of, that they are not of the Semitic bloodline. You heard me right. You can't be a Judahite if you're not of the Semitic bloodline. And then if you're telling people, as Christ did, beware of them that say they are Jews but are not, for they are the synagogue of Satan. Well, these are the words of Christ that these same people put to death. Those people that call themselves Jews today have historically been the assassins of our Lord and Savior. This is why there is such animosity between Christianity and Judaism, and why Judaism has stood up and put the Second World War Holocaust in front of itself to protect itself from the discriminatory attitudes of Christians around the world, knowing that they were responsible for murdering our Savior. It was their decision historically to reject the fact that he had come as God's son to redeem the world from this old covenant that he had had with his chosen people, the Judahite nation. That's only one tribe. There were many other tribes, but none of those tribes had any authority to add to God's law or take away from God's law, as we can see the corporate governments that are owned by these people doing today. Those corporations make statute, code, and regulation, bylaw, and ordinance every day of the week, all in violation of Deuteronomy 4:2, Deuteronomy 12:32. Again, this is a religious fraud where they put a woman up that says defender of the faith on the top with a King James Bible, a big ceremony where she got anointed with the oil. They put that up front so you would trust them. And then they teach you Romans 13 from the pulpit, so you'll submit yourself to them. Romans 13 has the word minister in it three times. And it's upon all of us to be diligent to find out what's going on in this world. And if that Romans 13 has been used via the pulpit and by the judges of the world to subjugate us, it's a good thing to examine what that word minister means, because it is indeed the subject matter of that whole chapter. It is used three times, and it is to who you are to submit to. So it is good in reflection and understanding that the simplicity of our language means that we must examine the words closely. I say simplicity, because if one examines words closely, then one can simply understand what the word means. It's not very complicated to go at word by word. It may take a long time, but the examination of a word is not a complex thing. As it turns out, that word minister, as used three times in Romans 13, is reflected well in Ezra chapter 7, 23 through 26, to give us an understanding of four conditions that must be met before any minister of Romans 13 can be accurately viewed. They must be of God's temple. That's the first predominating principle. They must pay no tax. That's the second predominating principle. They must adjudicate only with God's law. That's the third predominating principle, Deuteronomy 4:2, Deuteronomy 12:32, Matthew 15 and 9 prevailing in that position. And certainly they must teach them that know it not. Now we have four particulates of the position of a minister there as mentioned in the article God's Court Formation there in Ezra chapter 7. So I think if we have a closer look at those verses, 23 through 26, we can see that the use of the word minister there cannot be changed in any shape, form, or fashion when we read Romans 13. God is not the author of confusion. God forbid. We are to wisely discern the words. And so this is one of the major portions of the religious fraud that we've all been exposed to, because if we care to read Romans 13 carefully, we can see that it has been fraudulently interpreted. We have been lied to from the pulpit for 16 centuries. And this has changed the way the whole world would have viewed the Bible and the way the whole world would have been operating governmentally had it been taught properly. Had it been taught that it's only God's ministers with God's law that are adjudicating and they're in power and that are God's government, then we would have had a morally structured world, or we would not have the depravity and the breakdown of our society and the crime that we have today. We would have had a morally structured society. But that is not a profitable society for greedy men lusting after the power and energy of other men and women. That's why we have a religious fraud today. People like Constantine in the past that wanted to maintain power over the Roman authority. The power of Rome was like the Roman Empire, and he did not want it to fall, so he just changed the name of it from Rome to the Roman Catholic Church. He adopted a religion wherein he was getting run out of town. The Roman following of pagan gods was dying and had been taken over by Christianity. So rather than losing the power, he adopted the faith of Christianity and made the whole nation submit itself to it under the new label of the Roman Catholic Church. Now you can see that by altering the method of interpreting Romans 13, the Roman Catholic Church enabled itself to maintain power, subjugating all the people to it by utilizing Romans 13 as its hammer and chains. And that is what has taken place. Now, it's not very complicated to see that one word, the word minister in Romans 13, has been used for 16 centuries to effectively subjugate everybody that's ever gone to a church. Anybody that's ever been told, go register your children, go register and get a tax slave number. Those all came directions from the pulpit over 16 centuries. So it's a little difficult to grasp that this one fellow sitting in front of you on a screen, maybe thousands of miles away from you, could be truly exposing this 16th century fraud, and there wasn't one bit of error in what he was telling you. Now, I don't expect anybody to believe me, but I do expect people to go do the research and find out how these man-made governments of the day got to add to God's law and take away from God's law in corporate imagery when it's commanded that we don't do so in Deuteronomy 4:2, 12:32. And it's certainly put to us in Leviticus 18:3-4 that we are not to walk in the ordinances of heathen. And this would ring true in rhyming with Matthew 15:9, in vain do you worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. So here we have Christ himself admonishing us and saying, you're wasting your time worshiping me if you're going to be walking in the commandments of men and teaching people you're supposed to go register and submit yourself. Those are liars and deceivers. They're part of the fraud. They're part of the snake. So I'm hoping that people will accept this sort of condensed version of we've got Bible, God created man, man got choice, Deuteronomy 30:19. I said before you, life or death. Blessing and cursing. So we got two words to choose from. You get to choose them. You get to choose if you want to be a person and take the road of death and cursing, or if you want to be a minister and take the road of blessing and life. So these are the offers. One side of you, you have your Bible, and the other side of you, you have the ordinance of man, say the criminal code. And I've done a video about that before. I held the criminal code up, here's man's offer, and I held the Bible up, and I said, here's God's offer. That's Deuteronomy 30:19. If you're choosing God's offer of his law, you're his minister, John 15:16 applies to you. You've accepted his offer. If you choose man's law, well, then you're the person that Deuteronomy 1:17, 10:17, hated and rejected by God, James 2:9, a convinced sinner convicted of the law as a transgressor. So when you boil it down to those two words, and you can observe Constantine's fraud of hijacking Christ and superimposing the Romans 13 word minister in a false manner so as to make people submit to Rome, you can see that this fraud had a purposeful objective, is gaining your submission and taking your energy in the form of taxes. That's right, you've been used as a form of energy, a battery, so to speak, just like in the movie The Matrix. Your energy has been volunteered to this blood-sucking monster, this vampire that you've gone and registered yourself into and submitted yourself to, this dead prostitute, so to speak. The obvious conclusion for one that discovers that they're in bed with a dead prostitute is that no amount of creative copulation with a dead prostitute is going to produce any life-giving substance or virginity. And it's kind of a fallacy that many, many people across Canada and North America, worldwide, say, oh, well, there's UCC, you got to register your name up in the dead code, you ought to own your corporation, you got to get an EIN number, and you got to own all this dead corporate foul stuff that God condemns and says we're sinners if we affiliate with, associate with, or respect. Well, that kind of idiocy has left us with the two choices. There's blessing and cursing, and obviously there's no blessing with people that tell you to go into creative copulation with the dead prostitute, UCC. That's dead prostitute. It stinks, it smells, and they're trying to tell you to go put yourself into that, and you're going to achieve freedom out of it. They're lying to you, they're deceiving you, they've got no scriptural knowledge whatsoever, and they reject it. They won't take the time to read it. And some of you people know exactly who I'm speaking to. They refuse to dedicate their time to read those scriptures, to learn it. Instead, they speculate in their mind how they can beat and deceive these secular authorities using secular code and regulation. You are so deceived and mistaken. Nothing could be further from the truth. And yet there's some of you out there charging money to people to teach them these lies. And those of you that are doing it, you know who you are. You're asking people for money to teach them statute, code, and regulation. All this complicated, confusing stuff, as if it's going to help them. As if it's going to bring them out of Babylon and out of that dead prostitute's bed. When you touch it and you use it, you submit yourself to it. That's a very common old logic type of philosophy. If you use somebody else's property, you subject yourself to the authority of that owner. And that's what you're doing by using statute, code, and regulation and spewing it out of your mouth as if you were born with it. It's disgusting. It's foul. It sounds like you've been in a graveyard sucking off of the body of a dead one. So I think maybe those people that want to believe that they should post all this dead statute, code, and regulation and elevate themselves, oh, they're the only ones smart enough to understand it. And everybody goes, ooh, wow, they can cite statute, code, and regulation. They must be smart and our saviors. Nothing could be further from the truth. These people are misleading you and wasting your time, and you're never going to have a hope of bringing yourself closer to Christ when you're throwing mud at his wall. This is dirty. This is foul. Get yourself back to the scripture and demand accommodation. These international covenants, called the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the one on Social, Economic, and Cultural Rights, were put there to protect men and women. Article 3 of the ICCPR tells you you get to be a man or woman, and that means you get to set aside all that specious statute, code, and regulation argument, trying to make yourself look good as if you know much about it. How come you don't know much about the scripture and how to demand accommodation for your faith? That'd be a good question, because those people that work in the government believe you're a person. And all your use of statute, code, and regulation and 1099 specious arguments are only providing them more proof that you're a dumb goyim person of law that has no knowledge of God, respect of God, and certainly wishes to suck up to a dead prostitute and get engaged with necrophilia. That's what all of these spewers of statute, code, and regulation are inviting you to do. Get in bed with the dead prostitute. Look, I know all the various statute, codes, and regulations of the dead prostitute, and we can bind them with their dead stuff. You can't get life from death. And this is what I've been posting in many forums all over the place, and yet there's these people puffing themselves up with statute, code, and regulation as if they know something, and they got a lineup of people following them as if they're some world guru that everybody needs to know. Nothing can be further from the truth. Break open your Bible. Start teaching people the scriptures and demand accommodation from these dead corporate entities and point to their international covenants. Point them to the Vienna Convention, Article 27, that says that they can't use their dead statute, code, and regulation to bind you, intimidate you, nuisance you, or obstruct you from following the Bible. Wake up, folks. You're being misled by all these commercial gurus that are in bed with a dead corporate prostitute. They want to bring you into bed with that dead corporate prostitute so you can stink just like they do. And there's no life in that. You're certainly not getting closer to Christ and your blessing and inheritance. Please, for your sake and for the sake of your grandchildren and children's children, if you have any courage, you're going to go and ask, can I exercise faith without being intimidated by statute, code, and regulation? Can you direct me to where the statute, code, and regulation is that exists that allows you to force me into personage? Once I discover in those scriptures, I cannot correspond with or respect persons. Can you please direct me to what authority you may have to intimidate me to violate my faith and leave off of my dedication towards my Lord and Savior? If you find gurus teaching you that other than me, well, you want to cling to those people and bring them in touch with me. I'd certainly like to talk to those people. But all the rest of these dead dog corporate gurus that are out there lying to you, teaching you to submit yourself to a dead corporate prostitute, you'd be better off dividing yourself from those people. You're not going to find any love. You're not going to find any resolution. You're not going to find any redemption from the blood of Christ when you're being taught to stay in bed with a dead corporate prostitute. So I hope this little dialogue here today will awaken some of you as to the basics of the religious fraud. There, of course, is much more depth into the scripture than I've rendered here. I was just trying to give people a concise cut to the chase. God gave people choices. They could follow him or they could follow kings. They decided to follow kings, and here we are today. under statute, code, and regulation. That's King's. God's law was, don't add to my law, don't take away from it. I give you all you need. Love yourselves and each other and follow the rules. Don't get in each other's faces. Don't upset each other. Apologize. Mend the fence. Mend what you've broken. Replace what you've borrowed. All of these things are important rules to remember of things that we would want, how we would like other people to respect us. And so this is what's been missing. We haven't been following Christ's advice of Matthew 5:25, Matthew 18:15 through 20. He said to do it all by agreement. And agreement is what's most missing in today's world, because argument predominates. Everywhere you go is, oh, that's your argument. And people don't even reflect on the potential for agreement to be a better route. And I'm hoping my communication to you here today will bring everybody to the logical conclusion that, of course, any sane man or woman would have to say agreement is the superior method of communication. So I look forward to hearing back from any of you as to how you would like to utilize this method of agreement, your knowledge in gaining joining with others so that you could find other people that are along this same road, passionate towards the truth, and gaining agreement as to that truth with the other men and women that may have the assumption that they're a person of law submitted to a dead corporate entity. So I thank you again for your time, and I look forward to hear from any of you, your submissions, your questions, your answers, your help, your aid and direction as to how we can all come together and become a more powerful unit of men and women under the body and blood of Christ. I thank you so much for your time, and may God bless.